Welcome to Ebenezer Baptist Church. Thank you so much for joining us for worship. Let's stand and sing Resurrection Power. You called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old has passed the new. The new has come. Let's sing Resurrection Power. 1, 2, 3, 4. For this resurrection power. God, you changed us. Something special, something unique happens when we can say, I'm no longer bound by sin and darkness. I'm living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom, God. And this morning we come to you to thank you for that. We come to you to praise you for that. God, because if it was up to us, we couldn't earn it. There's nothing we could do. We could never be good enough. because of this dreadful sin. So God, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise because of your goodness, because of your mercy, and because of your love that saved us. And we can be confident that it will never be gone. You tell us that once we're yours forever. Once you've set us free, we are free. God, we sing hallelujah. We praise the one who set us free. And God, this morning we just pray that the worship that we give up to you is a joyful noise. We pray that you will overwhelm us with your love and your presence. And we pray all this in God's holy and precious name.
Thank you.
I don't know how many more times I'm going to do that. All right, so before we, Alicia and I are going to do a psalm that kind of goes along with the same message that we've been singing about this morning. But before we do so, I want to do something I've never really done this before, because I truly, honestly believe that this time is special to worship God and to praise God together as a church. But there's a young lady on this stage who ministers to you every single week. And she makes the biggest difference on this platform. And she uses this gift of playing her flute every single week. And we just love her to death. And today is actually her birthday. Yes, right? So I would love if we could just take a couple seconds to appreciate her and sing happy birthday to her. Can we do that? Any objections? All right, awesome. Let's do it. Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Maddie. Happy birthday to you. Thank you for that. Maddie, I don't know if all of you know her testimony, but I'm going to share part of it for her. She doesn't know any of this is happening. But she decided in sixth grade she made a mistake and didn't join band, right? She skipped band. And I was her band director in sixth grade. She didn't join. But during the summer, before seventh grade, she asked, can I join band in seventh grade? And I said, you got to take lessons. You got to catch up. You're a year behind. It would be like taking algebra and you don't know how to add yet. Right, you need to add to do algebra? Okay, so she took lessons from someone at the church here and got it into ready for the audition, and she auditioned as a seventh grader, and I said, yep, she's good. Her and her friend, Allison, and they came on, and quickly, by the end of the year, she's first chair. She just kept taking lessons, and she flew up to the top. And when I took the job here at Ebenezer, that was one of the things I was excited about, that she was here. And I was going to use her every single week. And she didn't know that at the time. But I teach, even in the public school system, when I get the opportunity, I teach them, listen, this is a gift. God has given you a gift. And he will bless it and bless you if you use it for him. And I don't care if it's music or singing, or pushing buttons, or baking, or cooking, or those are kind of the same. I mean, ministering to children, reading books, writing books, praying. I mean, there are gifts that each of us have been given by God. We are to use them. We are to fight through them. We are to practice them, and God will bless you for them. And she's just the perfect example. As a 17-year-old, she is changing people's lives with the music that God has blessed her with. So I just thank you for letting me take a moment and embarrass her. And we just appreciate you so much. I hope you know. All right, let's sing. This next song, if we'll go to the next slide, I want to show you one of my favorite scriptures of all time, John 8:36. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. And that's how it is. When you're saved, and you have been free indeed. And we've been singing about that. And this next song that we're about to sing is called Who You Say I Am. And the band is practicing it, and we're going to sing this as a congregation soon. But it's such a special song that talks of who we are because we have been set free. So be thinking about John 8:36 as we sing this.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Yes, I am. We at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Oh, he died. died for me, who the Son sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Amen. 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 I hope if you are here today, and you don't know if you are a child of God, I hope today you make that decision. We've sung a lot about being a child of God and the benefits of that. And the biggest benefit of that is that we will spend eternity with Christ forever. So I pray that you will see me or Pastor Jeremy or one of the deacons and leaders of the church today. If you haven't made that call, that decision, to be a child of God, I pray that today you will do that. Let's stand and sing one more. Amazing grace, my chains are gone. One, two, three, four.
Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart. I've been set free.
Well, good morning. Thank you all for worshiping with us this morning. It's great to see you all here today. And it is great to hear the sound of children's voices. It is a joy for me to see and hear so many children with us here today. And it is, it's a sign of a healthy church when we are together, gathered together of all ages and stages in life, worshiping God and ministering to one another. You know, at a very young age, one of the things that we are taught from a young age is how to find confidence and how to build confidence. And if you thought about different things that you've been taught and different things that you have gone through, there has been this season in life where you are building your confidence. But if you have noticed, and many times in our lives and in the lives of others, that sometimes that confidence building can then turn into arrogance, where we start to act maybe too confident and overly confident in ourselves. But when we think about this idea of confidence, and we think about the reality that two people can exude confidence, two people can come across as confident, two people on the exterior can be confident, but the question, though, is to ask, and what will always lead us to humility, what will always lead us to selflessness, is what we're putting our confidence in. What are we putting our confidence in? You know, right now, I think in life, especially with the whole, you know, this coronavirus and COVID thing and restriction thing and mask thing that just seems like it will never end. I think I'm starting to believe that. But what it has done for me, and I think many of you, is it causes us to find it very difficult to find rhythm, just to kind of find that. I'm a person that works well off of rhythms, you know, and I find kind of routines and rhythms, and I do well in those environments, and I don't mind change. But see, when change happens, then I develop and I find a new rhythm inside of that change. And what it's been really challenging, frustrating, and exhausting is it seems like that just can't happen. The minute that you find, you know, a rhythm, it seems like it's disrupted. The minute that you make a change and you start going in a different direction, something else happens. It seems like no matter what happens and what you try to do, your plans get canceled. The minute you think you're moving in a certain direction, that changes. But I want us to consider this morning that the time that we're living in right now, the days that we're walking through right now are putting us face to face with the reality that our confidence should not be found in ourselves. Our confidence should not be found in our circumstances. Our confidence should not be found in other people. Our confidence should not be found in what is going on around us. A confidence should not be found in our plans. And when we try to find it there, it's going to leave us unsettled. It's going to leave us disappointed. It's going to leave us discouraged. But this season that we're walking through in life is allowing us to see that all of those false assurances that we can put our confidence in will ultimately fail us, will let us down. It's that we are to put our confidence in Christ alone. He is our only hope. He is our peace. He is our strength. He is our everything. I want you to consider, and I tried to find one, but I couldn't come up with the illustration of a chair with three legs. I just didn't want to take a leg off of a chair, to be honest with you, for it. It's too much work. But I wanted you to imagine, though, a chair here on the stage with three legs on it. Or even going to dinner or going to a restaurant and pulling out the chair and there's a chair with three legs on it, right? Many of you would not feel very confident in sitting down on a chair with three legs on it, would you not? And some of you may say, well, I could probably figure it out. I could probably lean a certain way and maybe I could maneuver a certain way and I could sit on it a certain way where it would be okay for a while. But here's what we know about a chair with three legs. A chair with three legs is going to fail you. There's going to be that point where things shift and that chair goes down. You should not, it is not wise for you to put your confidence in sitting in a chair with three legs. We are fallen, broken people. We live in a fallen, broken world. And Paul is going to encourage this church at Philippi. Don't put your confidence in anything other than Jesus Christ himself. All other things will fail you. All other things will let you down. All other things are not what you are to put your confidence in. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Philippians chapter 3. And we're going to be starting in verse 1. Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same thing to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and the glory in Jesus Christ and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ. And be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Let's pray. Dear God, we are thankful that we are here today, thankful to see so many gathered here today, and so many that are with us right now online. God, we are thankful for who you are, a God that loves us and cares for us, a God that communicates with us, that desires to speak to us. And God, I pray this morning as we open your word and we study your scriptures, we recognize it is the power of the Holy Spirit in and among us that allows us to see the truths that's found in your word. God, I pray you speak to us in a powerful way. And God, I pray that we will be changed by your word. And I pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So when we look in the first section that Paul is, and as he's writing this letter to the church in Philippi, there's going to be one thing that happens in many of the churches that Paul would have ministered to, would have planted in these different areas, and that was this idea of a false Jewish teaching around the law. And so Christ alone was not going to be enough for salvation. They would say, yes, you can believe in Christ, you can believe that Christ raised from the dead, but you also have to follow some of these Jewish customs and some of the Jewish law and some of the Jewish traditions in order that you may be granted salvation. It is necessary, it's required. And so Paul understands the importance of teaching Christ alone as a source of our faith in him. And so what he's going to be writing, and he's writing this with a sense of confidence. And I want us to see the confidence and where that confidence is found. So he says in verse 1, "Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble for me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs, look out for the evildoers, look out for those who mutilate the flesh, for we are their circumcision, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ and put no confidence in the flesh." Now, first off, he's saying this is no trouble for me. This is no trouble for me to write this. This is easy for me to write this. Why? Because he believes it with all of his heart. This has changed his life. What he's sharing with them, the gospel of Jesus Christ, has changed everything for Paul. It's turned his life upside down. It's made him do a complete 180. It's made him leave his entire life behind. It's put him on a new path. He believes in it. He's willing to die for it. Therefore, it is no trouble for him to share this with you. It is no trouble for me to share this with you, he says. And it is safe for you. These words will not fail you. These words will protect you. These words are safe for you like they are for me. You know, when chaos is all around you, and when uncertainty is all around you, and when difficulty is all around you, and when suffering is all around you, and when pain is all around you, and when you feel that feeling of despair, that feeling of discouragement, that feeling of loneliness, that feeling of uncertainty, what you're looking for in that moment, what you're grasping for in that moment is safety. You want to be safe. You want to be in a place that is safe. You are searching for that sense of safety. Paul is saying, listen to these words, because these words are safe for you. These words will protect you. These words are safe for me. And then he goes on to describe a group of people, and he uses, first off, he talks about these dogs. So he says, look out for these dogs. Now today, dogs are a lot different, okay? Today, dogs are cute, and dogs are nice, and dogs are domesticated, and sometimes dogs are like a little accessory, like they fit in a bag, and they point their little cute head out, and, you know, they're different today. Like people, you know, like their little puppies and their dogs. But in that day, that was not how dogs were. Dogs were not domesticated. Dogs were nasty and filthy. And so this was not a, this was describing these group of people in a way to say that they are They're bad folk. It says they're dogs, they're evildoers, mutilators of the flesh. Now, you would think about this as Paul's describing this group of people. He's talking about the dogs and the evildoers and the mutilators of the flesh. You're thinking almost like this kind of satanic group of really bad people. That must be who Paul's talking about. This really bad group of people, watch out for those people. Like, he's warning them about those people. But who he's talking about is not a group of people that were breaking the law, you know, and killing people and stealing and doing all kinds of wrong things. That's not the group that Paul was talking about. Here's who Paul was talking about. He was talking about the Judaizers, folks in the church that were teaching a false gospel. These were good people. They followed the rules. They were well-liked in society. They didn't break the law. In fact, they kept the law. They weren't out killing people. And Paul is using this harsh language with this group of people. And he's saying, listen, there's actually a group of people that's more dangerous than the criminals out there. Let me tell you who those are. False teachers. False teachers are a dangerous group, Paul says. He says those teaching that you would need circumcision if you were male in order to be saved, to follow the Jewish law, that adding anything to the gospel of Jesus Christ, that faith alone and Christ alone is our means of salvation, is false teaching. And the idea behind false teaching is putting your confidence in something other than Christ. Putting your confidence in salvation and what you do and your behavior and how well you can follow the rules and what you may do externally. That's false teaching. False teaching says put your confidence in those things. Now, today, I think it's hard sometimes to translate that and say, what does that mean today? Because back then they were talking about circumcision and nobody's, you know, going around talking about those types of things or Jewish law or things that we should keep and things we should do. So what does that mean today? How does that work? Well, let me give you a couple of phrases that you may have heard. God helps those who help themselves. God doesn't give you more than you can handle. If you have enough faith, God will give you whatever you want. God's desire for your life is to be comfortable. That's false teaching. It's not true. It's not in the Bible. Our means of salvation is not God giving it to those that can help themselves. It's giving it to those that are helpless, giving it to those that realize that I can do nothing to earn my salvation. I can do nothing to pay for the salvation. I can do nothing to pay it back. I'm completely and utterly helpless and in need of a Savior. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. People would say God doesn't give you more than you can handle. I mean, I don't know about you, but I can think of many, many times in my life where I have done exactly what God's told me to do, and it's been way more than I can handle. I've done exactly what God's told me to do, and I felt underwater. In fact, the disciples did exactly what Jesus told them to do, and they found themselves in a storm that they never got themselves out of. See, God doesn't give us, God never promises that he won't give us more than he can handle. God promises us that it's his strength in us that will get us through things. It's that God will give us often more than we can handle in order that we recognize that we can't handle it and we rely more fully on him. And see, so there's false teaching all around us, and all false teaching centers on is saying, you look to you for your confidence. You look to you for your strength. You look to anything but Jesus in order to put your confidence in, to place your confidence in. And Paul's going to say this teaching is dangerous. It's not safe for you. It's destructive to the church, and we should be wary of it. And then he says that we are the true circumcision, which is the internal change, the heart that has been changed by the gospel. We have new life in Christ. We have hearts that have been changed by the gospel. It is us that possesses that. And don't let anyone take that from you. Don't let anyone ever try to convince you anything contrary. And then in verse 4, Paul says, though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Now, what Paul is going to say is, look, for those of you that may be teaching that you can find confidence in the flesh, confidence in your actions, confidence in your behavior, confidence in how you were born, the family that you came from. Paul's saying, I'm the poster child for that. I was the rising star. I was the one that came through the ranks. I was the born in the right family. I was a persecutor of the church. I followed the law perfectly. I was that person. Paul was gaining prominence. Paul was gaining status. Paul was that person. And he says, I possess those things. So if anyone is going to say to put confidence in those things, listen, you are talking to a person who has possessed them. You are talking to a person who has put their confidence in those things. Paul was that person. Paul was zealous for the Jewish law and eradicating Christianity off the map. It would be like a person saying, listen, if you're putting confidence in your money, I'm a billionaire. I was a billionaire. If you're putting confidence in your knowledge, I was a scholar. If you're putting confidence in your strength, I was stronger. Whatever that may be for you, if you're putting confidence in other things, I've been there. I've experienced that. I know what it's like. I've done it. You know, for many of us in life, the things that are bothering you the most right now about what you've lost oftentimes are the things that you're putting your confidence in. We tend to put our confidence in fleshly things. We like to be self-reliant. I know for me, I'm a person that just likes to be self-reliant. I like to just get it done, do it myself, figure it out. And I can tell you, a time like this is really frustrating for a person like me. Because there's just days where you're like, there's just nothing I can do. Or I thought I had a plan, but the plan got changed. Or I thought I had a thing, but this direction, or I'm going to just do this, or I'm going to try this, or I'm going to try that. And see what happens is that over and over and over again, it just doesn't work. And Paul's going to say, don't put your confidence in the flesh. Don't put your confidence in your works. Don't put your confidence in your discipline and your behavior and your drive, because I've done that. I know what it's like to do that. In verse 7, he says, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, and not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. So what he's saying is, listen, nothing that I had and nothing in my life that I had formerly put confidence in, none of those things, whatever that may be for you, and all of us have things. All of us have something in our life that we're putting our confidence in. And what Paul's saying is, listen, all the things that I possessed and all the things that I had and all those areas in my life where I put confidence in, I count it as rubbish. I count it as loss when I found Jesus. See, I found something better. See, what Paul's going to say is that for the years and years and years that he had been living that way and putting his confidence in the flesh, putting his confidence in his own behavior, putting his confidence in following the law, putting his confidence in himself, see, there's a day where he realized that was like sitting on a three-legged chair. All of those things were going to let him down. That's what the gospel shows us, is that everything that you put your confidence in yourself is going to let you down. If you put your confidence in just being a good person, at some point you're going to sin and fall short. Being strong enough, at some point you're going to be weak. There's going to be some point in your life where whatever you put your confidence in, it is going to let you down. You put confidence in other people, they're going to fail you. Confidence in relationships, they're going to let you down. Whatever that may be, it's like sitting on a three-legged chair. The day is coming. And Paul says, compared to Christ, it all loses its value. Paul's going to say, I had a lot, I possessed a lot, I knew a lot, and I had a lot of confidence in myself. But then there came to a point where I realized it was all rubbish. Now, what makes it rubbish? It's like if you ever go, you know, house shopping, if you're looking for a new home or a new car, they tell you to never start by looking at things you can't afford, right? That's the worst thing you should ever do. So if you're looking for a house, don't go tour houses that you can't afford. If you're looking for, you know, if you're looking for a new car, don't go test drive cars that you can't afford. I remember one time I was at a dealership, and I came into the dealership. I was right out of college. I was looking for a car, had a very specific budget, and the sales guy, you know, he comes and he's like, I don't have a car like that. He's like, but why don't you go take that test drive in that car out there and then come back and tell me what you can do? And I looked at him and I just said, if that test drive is going to knock about 15 grand off the price of that car, then I'm all for it, okay? But if not, I don't need to test drive it. I know it's going to be nice, okay? I know it's going to be nicer than what I want to buy. And see, that's the thing, is when we find something better, when we find something greater, it makes what you have seem like rubbish, doesn't it? Paul's going to say, whatever I had, whatever I possessed became rubbish to me when I found Christ. When I found something better, when I found the thing that I could put all of my confidence into, the one that would never fail me, the one that would secure my future, the one that paid the debt that I could not pay. Paul says, when I found Christ, everything I had before me, I counted as loss because of the value, the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ. You know, it's easy to walk away from something when you are trading it for something better. It's easy for us to do. Whenever it's easy for us to get rid of something, to trade something in, to let something go, when we're trading that for something that's far better. I mean, we all know that to be true. Like, if you are a person who, like the car analogy, I mean, if someone came to me in the parking lot right now and said, Jeremy, I'll take your 2006 Avalon and I will trade you for a brand new car, I'd be like, done. You know, I wouldn't be out there like crying about the scratches and the memories I had from my kids scratching the car. I'd be like, you can take that thing. I want to sign this title as fast as I can before you change your mind, right? Why? Because I am trading it for something better. Now, if somebody steals my car in the parking lot, I'm going to be sad. It's the same with Christ. When we find something that is far better, far greater, it makes giving up those other things easy. That's what Paul says. He says, when I found something greater, when I found something I could truly place my confidence in, it was easy to walk away from all those things that were going to fail him. See, Paul had confidence. Paul was, in many instances, very confident. He was bold in his proclamation of the gospel. Paul was the guy who would stand there and proclaim the gospel and have his life be in danger. Paul was the one that would speak out when it wasn't cool to speak out. Paul, in many instances, was near death, was spared his life by God alone. He was bold, he was confident, but he found no confidence in himself. His confidence was in Christ. You know, this morning, we're sharing information with you today about a pastor that we're looking to hire, and it is a huge move for our church. It is a big move that we're making, And I'll tell you that back months and months ago, I remember when I was sharing the vision initially with the deacons, and I kind of put it all together and was praying through it and really felt a prompting by God to say, this is the time you need to share it, you know, with these guys. And I was nervous. I really was. I was like, how are they going to respond? You know, how are they going to say? What are they going to say? And I was nervous sharing it with them. And in that moment, I felt like God was saying, this is what I want you to do. So this is when I want you to do it. So I did. And then I remember when we decided as a group that I needed to share that with the church, I was nervous. How are they going to respond? What are they going to say? What are they going to do? How is this going to be perceived? And then again, I felt very much confident that God was wanting me to share it with the church then. And then in the middle of the coronavirus, when I wanted the deacons to interview a candidate that I felt that God may have been sending our way, I was nervous. What are they going to say? How are they going to respond? How are they going to take this? And I'm nervous today, sharing with you what we've been praying about and seeking God's will on for months and months and months. I'm nervous. But here's what I want to let you know. That I can stand here today confident. Not confident in the facts and figures, not confident in how it looks on paper, not confident in the timing. I am confident that it is God's will, God's direction, God's plan, and that's 100% where I find my confidence. It's in Christ. It's found in my firm belief that it's the direction that God wants us to go in. Because here's the reality. I don't know the future. Our deacons don't know the future. We don't know next week. We don't know next month. We don't know next year. I don't know what's best for this church. I don't know what's best for this community. I don't know what's best for myself. And I don't know what's best for my family. But my confidence comes not in that, but from following Jesus. Because Jesus knows us, Jesus guides us, Jesus loves us, and I love him. And that's why I'm confident today. And that's why I encourage you all, in whatever phase and whatever stage of your life, don't find confidence in yourself. Find it in Christ. In verse 10 it says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. And so what's interesting here in verse 10 is that Paul goes on to say, not only is it that he's finding his confidence in Christ, but his view of suffering is different than many of us would view suffering. Many times we view suffering as suffering is something that we have to go through as Christians. Suffering is part of being a Christian, and then God gets us through those sufferings. And that's true. But Paul actually sees a deeper meaning and a deeper purpose in sufferings. He says not only that he says that sufferings are going to come, he says that I may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Paul says suffering is part of the sanctification process, part of making me more like Christ. In 2 Corinthians 1:8, he says, we do not want you to be unaware, brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. But indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. And listen, so I just want to back up. So Paul's saying to his church in Corinth, he says, we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. You ever felt like that? Have you ever felt utterly burdened beyond your own strength? Have you ever felt like that you were at a moment, that you were at a time, that you were at a season in your life where you were burdened to the point that you just didn't have it in you to keep going? where this was way bigger than you, way more than you could handle? Paul says, we were there. We didn't even know, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. Now listen carefully to these next words. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. I want to read that again. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. See, Paul didn't just see suffering as a way of something that he had to get through, that God got him through. What Paul says is that suffering, those afflictions we went through, and they were great. They were the type of afflictions and suffering where we didn't even know if we were going to live, where we anticipated our own death, where we were burdened beyond our ability to stand. And he says, and those were there. We walked through that so that we would not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. See, Paul saw that suffering is like falling off of a three-legged chair. Paul saw suffering like sitting on that chair and having that chair fall and going down hard and hitting the ground and getting up and seeing that I shouldn't sit on a three-legged chair. This is going to fail me. Paul says suffering is, in those instances, is going to show you that whatever you can put your confidence in is going to fail you. He says it's going to make you rely not on yourselves, because suffering starts to remove that from you. When you are in despair, you realize you don't have what it takes. You don't have enough strength. You're not in control. He says to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. I want you to consider this morning. I think God is using this time in many of our lives in many different ways, whatever that may be for you, whatever that burden is for you, whatever that stress is for you, whatever that affliction is for you, whatever you're going through. I want you to consider that God may be using this time in your life so that you don't rely on yourself, but on God who raises the dead. I want you to think about your circumstance. I want you to think about your situation. I want you to think about whatever you're walking through and going through. And I want you to consider this. Is it bigger than God raising Jesus Christ from the dead? That's who we're following. That's who we're serving. That's who's guiding us. And Paul says, don't put your confidence in yourself. Put your confidence in the one who raised Jesus from the dead. I believe that many of us in our lives are experiencing that. We're fighting with God over it. We're frustrated about it. But God may be using this season in your life so that you might not rely on yourselves, but on God who raises the dead. You know, I think it's interesting this morning, and I'll share more with you later, but I think it's very interesting God's timing and how he has led us in this pastor that we have been interviewing and seeking and we're presenting to you this morning. The timing of the COVID and the timing of all of the uncertainty that we have just in the world and in the church, that just seems to be a really weird time to do all of this. And even as I was preparing this message this morning, God's gonna get me on camera on that one. Then you're really gonna be like, Jeremy, you work on Sundays, what else you do? But as I was working through this, as preparing this, I really felt like God may be using this time so that we rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. We might have lots of questions, we may have lots of what ifs. But Paul says, don't rely on yourself, but rely on God who raises the dead. Jeremy, don't rely on yourself. Rely on God who raises the dead. This morning, you have a choice. You can rely on yourself. You can rely on things around you. You can rely on other people. You can rely on money. You can rely on your own strength. You can rely on your own discipline. You can rely on all the different things that you can in the flesh, and they will fail you. Or you can rely on God who raises the dead. In church this morning, we have a decision to make. We can rely on ourselves. We can rely on the facts. We can rely on the figures. We can rely on what's happening around us. We can rely on information in front of us. Or we can rely on the God who raises the dead. Let's pray. Dear God, we're thankful for this time that we have together. God, I'm thankful that we're able to gather here together. And God, I'm especially thankful for the parents that are here today, the commitment that they've made to bring their children to worship. Thank you, God, for them. And I pray that this would be a blessing to them and a blessing to their children, God. And God, I thank you for your word and the timing of it. Do you know exactly what we need when we need it? And God, I pray that this morning, so many in this room are struggling. So many of us are in seasons of despair. God, I pray that we would have our eyes open this morning, that maybe the seasons we're walking through, the things we're walking through, the situations that we find ourselves in are your loving, gracious way of allowing us to not rely on ourselves, but on you who raises the dead. God, I pray that as the people here gathered today, whether in person or online, that our prayer would be that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. I pray we trust Jesus, we follow him, and that the sight of Jesus and what we experience in just knowing Jesus makes all things of the earth become rubbish in our eyes. God, I pray you give us faith and courage and strength to follow you. And I pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. This is a time for us to respond. However you're led this morning, whatever God's leading you to do, whatever he's laying on your heart, however you feel best that you are to respond to the word of God, it is our responsibility to respond to the word of God. Whatever that may be for you, it may be something that you need to pray about, it may be a commitment that you need to make, a decision you need to make, whatever that may be for you, I pray that during this time when we stand and we sing, that you'd follow Jesus, that you'd make that commitment, that you'd pray that prayer, that you'd make that decision, whatever that is for you. Let us stand, let us sing. All right, well, y'all please be seated for a few moments. We've got some things to share with you today.